Hi guys, this is Dr. Patil and I teach medicine for An Academy, and today we are connecting to discuss osteoarthritis. This session is mainly planned for those who are preparing for next 2023 so that you have sufficient time to go through or kind of do a deep dive into the topic and understand every topic from the depth. Okay, now before I start with the topic, let me introduce you to the NEET-PG Combat that An Academy is conducting right now. It is scheduled on 19th of December. So do give it a try, and also be aware that An Academy is coming out with a NEET PG 2022 Ultimate Revision Package. This may be very, very helpful because the structure is that there is test and discussion included, 150 hours of test and discussion. Now, when you have less time, you guys know that it is probably going to be conducted in the month of March or maybe April. Even if it is postponed, I don't see it being postponed beyond June. So in that case, you have less time. And when you have less time, probably one strategy that really works well is the test and discussion approach, because it tunes you for the MCQ approach. And that is probably the most important thing rather than knowing theory. If you're a candidate who are preparing for next 2023, I would still recommend you to do a detailed reading from your notes, textbooks, or whatever is your source of preparation. Attend the live lessons as much as possible. Listen to theory sessions as much as possible. And then in the last leg of your preparation, when there is around 4 or 5 months left, maybe you can start thinking of the test and discussion. But for the NEET PG 2022, I would bank on the test and discussion. And if you use the code MEDLOVE, MEDLOVE, you may get a handsome 10% discount. Okay. Now let me start with the topic. What are we discussing? We are discussing osteoarthritis. Right. Okay. So the first point to note is that osteoarthritis is the most common arthritis overall. Right. So what do I mean by that? Even if you take into account rheumatoid arthritis and arthritis related to SLE and various other causes, post-traumatic, everything put together, osteoarthritis is still the leading cause of arthritis. Okay. And I can rephrase the same sentence in a little different way and say most common type of age-related degenerative joint disease, that is also osteoarthritis. And in the recent times, there is increasing prevalence. That is mainly due to, first and important thing is that there is longevity achieved. So people are living for a longer period of time now in comparison to 6 or 7 decades earlier. And because of that, we have increased aged population. So the percentage of the living population that is formed by geriatric group is increasing. It is expanding. Right? And that means that more and more of those patients will be experiencing osteoarthritis, and thus the prevalence is increasing. And we also know that obesity is an important risk factor for osteoarthritis, and in general, the prevalence of obesity is increasing because of the sedentary lifestyle and whatever the 21st century challenges that brings in. Right. Okay. The next point I want you to note that it is a degenerative arthritis. So we have this classification of inflammatory and non-inflammatory arthritis, and among the non-inflammatory arthritis, this comes into picture, degenerative arthritis. So when we say inflammatory arthritis, the classical example for that is rheumatoid arthritis, right? It's a classical example for that. This is not a inflammatory arthritis. So I have already discussed the differences between inflammatory and non-inflammatory arthritis in one of the sessions. Okay. What are the commonly involved joints? So there is a characteristic involvement of first carpometacarpal joint. This is very, very characteristic, and this is an MCQ point. If there is an MCQ asking you the involvement of first carpometacarpal joint, where is that located? Base of the thumb. Base of the thumb. So involvement of this first carpometacarpal joint is very, very characteristic of osteoarthritis. So tomorrow they may even give you an x-ray of the hand where you can see the osteoarthritis changes at the base of the thumb, and the diagnosis is pretty straightforward. It is osteoarthritis in that case. Similarly, there may be involvement of metatarsophalangeal joints, which can also be seen in gout. So that I wouldn't say that it is very, very characteristic of osteoarthritis. It can also be seen in gout, but this first carpometacarpal joint, right? First carpometacarpal joint, that is very characteristic. Okay. Then hip joint and knee joint are very frequently involved. In fact, knee joint being a weight bearing joint, right? It is probably very, very characteristically involved in obesity related osteoarthritis. Hip joint involvement is not uniformly reported, but it is very common in the Western population. Okay. And if you talk about the small joint involvement, then PIP and DIP, proximal as well as distant interphalangeal joints, are involved. this distal interphalangeal joint involvement is like kind of characteristic of osteoarthritis, because we see that in case of rheumatoid arthritis, this is spared. There is no involvement of DIP, right? So sparing of DIP is characteristic of rheumatoid arthritis. But in case of osteoarthritis, and one more condition where we see DIP involvement is psoriatic arthritis, right? So psoriatic arthritis and osteoarthritis are two conditions I want you to remember where there is involvement of distal interphalangeal joints. The joints that are usually spared, another important area for MCQs, right? So the joints that are usually spared include wrist. Now we know that wrist is probably the first joint that starts showing changes in case of rheumatoid arthritis, right? Distal radio ulnar joint is the one that starts showing the earliest site to look for rheumatoid arthritis changes, right? But in case of osteoarthritis, there is no involvement of this joint, right? So there is no involvement of wrist, there is no involvement of ankle and elbow. These are kind of commonly involved joints in case of rheumatoid arthritis. I do agree that the small joints are more predominantly affected, but if you have to talk about large joints, these are the ones which are very commonly involved. On the other hand, it is the knee and hip that are commonly involved in case of osteoarthritis. Now coming to the risk factors. So what are the risk factors? Age is the most important, the most potent risk factor. So hardly there are any cases of osteoarthritis which are diagnosed before 40. If you're diagnosing osteoarthritis before 40, probably a very important additional contributor would be obesity. Obesity would be an additional important contributor, or else there may be trauma which is contributing to the osteoarthritis, right? So if it is occurring before 40, it is very, very rare. In that case, obesity may be one of the contributing factor, or trauma may be a contributing factor. Okay. Female gender in general is a risk factor. Particularly, the risk exponentially increases in postmenopausal period. So postmenopausal women are at increased risk. Genetic contribution particularly becomes important if you have to talk about a subtype of osteoarthritis called as generalized nodular osteoarthritis. Generalized nodular osteoarthritis. So this is one subtype of osteoarthritis where there is symmetry, very characteristic symmetry, and there is involvement of small joints of the hand, and this is the variant where we see these Hebelden's nodes and Bouchard's nodes, right? So in those cases, there is a strong role of genetics, because we see those type of osteoarthritis or the nodular osteoarthritis clustering in families. On the other hand, the osteoarthritis where the knee is predominantly affected, we can call it as isolated knee joint osteoarthritis, which is obesity related, and thus there is very limited familial clustering. Okay. So if I have to talk about genetics, I wouldn't really think too much about its involvement, but we still should remember one or two important points. So there's a gene called GDF5. So certain polymorphisms in this may be associated with increased risk. And if you have to talk about HLA-A1 and B8, right? So when I was talking about rheumatoid arthritis, I told you that I want you to remember HLA-DRB1 and DR4 for rheumatoid arthritis. Similarly, in case of osteoarthritis, it is B8 and A1. These carry some degree of additional risk if you are carrying these HLA variants. What are the other risk factors? I have already elaborated about it. Trauma is an important risk factor, especially if there is joint malalignment for whatever is the reason. In most cases, it is because of post-trauma. If there is joint malalignment, that is a definitive risk factors. And patient may present much sooner than the conventional case of osteoarthritis. So usually they're not diagnosed before 40, but in case of post-traumatic cases, they may be diagnosed before 40 years of age also. Obesity, we definitely understand that it is an important risk factor, especially for the knee joint osteoarthritis, isolated knee joint osteoarthritis. Okay, then repetitive use of joints and exercises, they also contribute, because it is believed that the particles released from the wear and tear of the joint surfaces are the ones which are triggering the degenerative changes. Okay, and also remember that 1/3 to 2/3 of cases, like you can say 30 to 60, 70% of the cases, also have some degree of evidence of chondrocalcinosis. What is chondrocalcinosis? There is deposition of CPPD crystals in the joints, right? So that is also considered as an important risk factor. And I want you to remember this, because not every literature talks about it, but this is a point which can be asked as an MCQ. Okay. Coming to pathogenesis, I will try to simplify it for the sake of remembering. Too much details are not required. So normally what happens, these chondrocytes secrete a substance called as matrix metalloproteinases, MMPs. They are secreted by chondrocytes and they are usually in the inactive state. They can be activated either by interleukin 1 or similar inflammatory cytokines or the plasmin. Right? So if there is increased plasmin production inside the joint, or if there is increased production of interleukin 1, then this inactive MMP is converted to active MMP, and that leads the tissue destruction. Right. So whenever there is wear and tear and trauma to the joints, right, with that kind of triggers the local inflammation. So obviously that is why age becomes an important risk factor. That is why trauma and joint injury becomes important risk factor. That is why obesity becomes important risk factor. So in response to this wear and tear particles, interleukin 1 is secreted. And this interleukin 1 converts inactive matrix metalloproteinases to active matrix metalloproteinases. Okay. This interleukin 1 can also stimulate conversion of plasminogen to plasmin, which in turn again activates inactive to active MMP. And this active MMP, matrix metalloproteinases, so they cause cartilage matrix destruction, and that is why we see cartilage destruction. So the mainstay of injury in case of osteoarthritis is basically cartilage destruction, right? This is the main abnormality. Right? So that is about pathophysiology. I want you to remember the role of interleukin 1. Okay. So this is probably the most important or the main cytokine in case of osteoarthritis. Now coming to clinical features. Obviously there is a joint destruction, so we do experience that there would be pain. So pain, patients do experience pain in and around the joints. And this may be associated with early morning stiffness. Early morning stiffness. I want you to remember that early morning stiffness can be seen in both inflammatory as well as non-inflammatory arthritis. But its involvement is usually not long-lasting. In the sense, it only lasts less than 30 minutes. So if the patient gets up in the morning and if he is experiencing stiffness of the joints, it won't last for more than 30 minutes. If it is lasting for more than 30 minutes, it leans towards the diagnosis of inflammatory arthritis, right? Like rheumatoid arthritis. Okay, so remember this point. And in fact, to be very frank, in case of rheumatoid arthritis, majority of the cases, the early morning stiffness lasts more than 1 hour. And this is one important distinguishing feature between the inflammatory and non-inflammatory arthritis. So in fact, there are 2 points to remember from this inflammatory versus non-inflammatory arthritis. The first point is obviously the early morning stiffness. The second point is the number of WBC cells in the synovial fluid. The WBC count will be more than 2K in case of inflammatory, and it will be less than 2K in case of non-inflammatory. And because osteoarthritis is a non-inflammatory, if you do a synovial fluid analysis, you're expecting less than 2K WBCs per cubic millimeter. Okay. Then another history finding that helps us to identify these disorders is that the pain is usually aggravated by putting the joint in use. So if you, there will be some degree of diurnal variation in the sense that in case of osteoarthritis, because the pain is aggravated by repetitive use of joint, right, the pain is probably worse in the evening. So throughout the day, patient is putting that joint into action, and in the evening he experiences severe pain. On the other hand, in case of rheumatoid arthritis, the typical example of inflammatory arthritis, what do we see is that the pain is worse in the morning, and as day progresses, they may feel a little better with the pain. And that holds good for even early morning stiffness. Right? So early morning stiffness gets relieved by putting the joint in action in inflammatory disorders, and the pain gets better by putting the joint in action. But here the pain is aggravated by joint use. Okay. Additional point I want you to remember, this can be asked as an MCQ. Remember, cartilage is devoid of nerve endings. So the pain that we pursue if we have osteoarthritis is originating from other supportive joint structures and not from the cartilage. Okay. What do we see on examination? The characteristic inflammatory signs are supposed to be absent. We may see some degree of inflammatory signs. So this is a non-inflammatory arthritis. So the redness and joint swelling are not supposed to be there, but in some cases we may still see them. Okay, so the presence of inflammatory signs absolutely doesn't rule out osteoarthritis. It is still a possible diagnosis. But if at all you are noticing swelling, it is most likely bony rather than from the soft tissue. In case of inflammatory arthritis like rheumatoid arthritis, if there is joint swelling, it is mainly because of the swelling and increase of synovial fluid. Okay, so the synovial structures are contributing to the swelling. But in case of osteoarthritis, the swelling is mainly bony. So you would know that there is new bone formation in osteoarthritis. So this new bone formation in the form of osteophytes contributes to swelling. Okay. And because the cartilage is destroyed, the joint friction might give rise to crepitus. So when you move the joint, you may be able to hear some degree of crepitus. And the muscles in and around the joint may be wasted. One reason could be that there may be some local inflammatory reaction, and the second and probably the most important reason why there will be muscle wasting is that because of the pain and apprehension, patient may not be putting the joint in use, and that explains why there may be muscle wasting, right? Okay. Now coming to subtypes of osteoarthritis, there are four subtypes. The first one is generalized nodular. So obviously that means it is generalized. Usually this type is symmetric. This is generalized. This is usually symmetric, and this is characterized by, as the name says, nodular, right? So formation of nodes, right? This is the type where we see Heberden's and Bouchard's nodes. The second subtype is erosive osteoarthritis, where there is involvement of interphalangeal joints. Okay, the third one is isolated knee joint osteoarthritis, and obviously that means it is related to obesity, right? So in the very beginning, I had told you that in case of generalized osteoarthritis, or what we call as nodular osteoarthritis, genetics probably plays some role, because there is familial clustering of these types. Okay. The last one is spinal. So these are the four subtypes of osteoarthritis. Now coming to some important pictorial questions. Right? So every now and then they do put up these images of Heberden's nodes or Bouchard's nodes, or they may mark a particular location and ask you to identify whether it is Heberden's nodes or Bouchard's nodes or some related nodular disorder like rheumatoid nodules. Those things are usually mentioned as an option, right? So remember, Heberden's nodes and Bouchard's nodes, you should be able to pinpoint whether it is the, say for example, this image, right? Heberden's node. This is from, you can see there is a nodule in the distal interphalangeal joint. So Heberden's nodes are mainly affecting the DIP. On the other hand, you can notice in this image, there is a nodule or a node in the proximal interphalangeal joint. That is Bouchard's node. So how do we remember? How not to get confused? You know the alphabetical order, A, B, C, D, E, F, J. So in the alphabetical order, B comes first in the order of joints, right? Again, proximal comes first, distal comes later, right? So B, proximal in the alphabetical order, so that is affecting the proximal interphalangeal joint. H comes later, distal in the alphabetical order, so obviously that is affecting distal interphalangeal joints. Okay. Now if you take an x-ray of a patient suffering from osteoarthritis, right, particularly we would be taking x-ray from the knee joint because that is the common complaint in the elderly population, what are the radiological findings we are going to see? So I want you to remember some three or four important things. The first one is joint space narrowing. Joint space narrowing. Why I want you to remember? This is the earliest radiological finding. Okay. And what is the hallmark of osteoarthritis on the radiological images? The hallmark is formation of new bone called osteophytes. Right? So presence of osteophytes is the hallmark. Osteophytes is the hallmark of osteoarthritis. Okay. Apart from that, two more things to note. There will be subchondral bone sclerosis. Subchondral bone sclerosis, and there may be a cyst formation. We call it a subchondral cyst. Okay, let me clearly try to show that. You can probably appreciate the boundary of this subchondral cyst. Right. And what is sclerosis? Kind of a fibrotic response, right? So there will be subchondral bone sclerosis. So what is the earliest pathological change? Cartilage destruction. Once the cartilage destruction happens, underneath the cartilage, whatever is the subchondral bone, there will be some degree of inflammatory activities happening there also, and as a response to that, bone responds by formation of sclerosis. Okay, if the destruction is severe enough, it tries to form new bone. That is what leads to osteophytes. So that is the response from the bone. Okay, so these are the radiological changes that we are seeing. You can clearly appreciate there is joint space narrowing on this side in comparison to the other side, right? You can appreciate that. You can probably appreciate the sclerosis of the bone. You can appreciate osteophytes in this region. I know it is not very clear. Let me see if I can pick up another image which clearly shows osteophytes. You can appreciate the subchondral bone cyst. The other thing you may be able to appreciate is formation of loose bodies, which I don't see in this image, but if I come across an image, I will try to show you that. Okay, so these are the radiological findings. Then we also have this radiological grading of osteoarthritis, and this is also an important area for MCQ. What we should know? The name of this radiological grading system is Lorenz and Kellgren classification. Lorenz and Kellgren classification, and there are four grades. Before going into the grades, remember, I already made a statement. I said that the earliest radiological finding is joint space narrowing. But when it comes to grading, right, remember, I'm just giving you a hack to remember this table, or if you are a final MBA students, to reconstruct this table in writing a essay answer. What is the hack? Remember, osteophytes lead over joint space narrowing. This is just a hack to remember. So in grade 1, what is happening? There is doubtful joint space narrowing. Pay attention to the wordings. Doubtful joint space narrowing, but possible osteophytic lipping. Right? So possible osteophytic lipping. Doubtful joint space narrowing, possible osteophytic lipping. That means joint space narrowing, shayad hai nahi. But there is some evidence to say that there may be an osteophyte being formed. That is grade 1. So I made this statement, right? Osteophytes are leading the joint space narrowing. So osteophytes appear first in the grading system. In reality, yes, the earliest change is joint space narrowing. Okay. So in grade 1, there is doubtful narrowing of the joint space and there is possible osteophytic lipping. In grade 2, what happens? There is definite osteophytes. Right? So osteophytes become definite now. Right? You confirm that I can say on this X-ray, there are osteophytes present. Right? But what happens to joint space narrowing? It is possible, yeah. Right. So I already gave you an MCQ point. Evidence of definite osteophytes on X-ray means what grade? That means we are talking about grade 2. Right. And if you move to grade 3, what you notice is that osteophytes become moderate in size and they become multiple in number. And this is the first time we hear the wording definite joint space narrowing. So definite osteophytes is in grade 2, definite joint space narrowing is in grade 3. Two important MCQ points we already covered, right? Now what happens in grade 4? In grade 4, the osteophytes become larger. So there was possible lipping in grade 1, they become definite osteophytes in grade 2, they become moderate multiple osteophytes in grade 3, and they become large osteophytes in grade 4. Okay. Coming to joint space narrowing, it was doubtful in grade 1, it becomes possible in grade 2, it becomes definite in grade 3. So joint space narrowing appears one grade after the osteophytes, right? So that is the point I was trying to tell you, so that you can reconstruct this table. Okay, what else happens in grade 4? There is marked joint space narrowing, severe sclerosis of the bone, and for the first time you hear this word, definite bone end deformity. So this bone end, you can see from one of the previous images, the bone end is not showing so much of deformity, but yes, you may be able to appreciate that there is some degree of deformity. So the bone end deformity is definitely present in grade 4. It is possibly present in case of grade 3. Right. So three MCQ points to note. Point 1, definite osteophytes, grade 2. Point 2, definite joint space narrowing, that is grade 3, and definite bony end deformity, that is grade 4. Right. So that is about Lorenz and Kellgren. Remember in Bandoka Naam, Lorenz and Kellgren classification. Now it is in modification, but from the exam's perspective, if you remember the original one, that is more than enough. Okay. Now coming to investigations, obviously, probably the chest X-ray is the most important investigation. You can also do the MRI as well as the CT of the joints, but most cases we do X-ray. And I have already given you these two important examination points, right? Hallmark of osteoarthritis on X-ray is osteophytes. The earliest feature or earliest radiological evidence is in the form of joint space narrowing. If at all you go on to do a synovial fluid analysis, because this is a non-inflammatory arthritis, you see that the WBC count is less than 2000, and I have already told you that 1/3 to 2/3 patients, 30 to 70% of the patients may have some degree of chondrocalcinosis, and thus you may be able to appreciate presence of CPPD crystals from their synovial fluid. Okay, that is about investigation. Now coming to treatment, because this is a degenerative disorder, age makes an important contribution, obesity makes an important contribution, there is an important role of non-pharmacological treatment also. So weight loss plays an important role, and it is definitely recommended, especially in the early stage of osteoarthritis. Now if it is an advanced osteoarthritis and there is severe joint destruction, probably it is impractical, and making an attempt, pushing the patient for exercise may be a little more harmful. But all the guidelines do recommend that weight loss should be tried at least in the early stages of osteoarthritis. If we can achieve weight loss, probably the progression of osteoarthritis is significantly slowed down, right? So weight loss is one thing we can do. Exercise are particularly important even in the setting of severe osteoarthritis. Some degree of tolerable exercises may be recommended, because exercises can be used to correct the posture and strengthen the muscles which support the joint. Okay. And if patient needs supportive devices, you may offer them canes, crutches or orthotic shoes. That is the non-pharmacological treatment. Then there was an important role of nutraceuticals, at least it was thought to be so in the past. So there are a lot of orthopedicians and dermatologists who used to prescribe these substances called chondroitin sulfate or glucosamine sulfate. I understand that they are integral part of the structures of the joint tissues, but supplementing them has not shown any consistent benefit from studies to studies. And that is why American College of Rheumatology does not recommend use of nutraceuticals. There is recommendation for weight loss, there is recommendation for exercises, but there is no recommendation for nutraceuticals. Okay. Now coming to pharmacological treatment, I will only give you some important points to remember. Probably my pharmacology colleagues will be covering this topic in detail. The points I want you to remember, that there is something called as disease modifying osteoarthritis drugs. Just like how we have disease modifying anti-rheumatoid drugs, we also have disease modifying osteoarthritis drugs. Okay. And from this list, I particularly want you to remember diacerin. Why I want you to remember diacerin? Because it is routinely used these days, and it is an interleukin-1 antagonist, or it blocks interleukin-1's action. It is thought to block interleukin-1's action. I was preferably emphasizing on the role of interleukin-1 in the pathogenesis of osteoarthritis, because we are devising drugs against this particular molecule. Okay. Then beyond any doubt, there is definite role of NSAIDs for the pain control, no doubt about it. And I also want you to remember these two new drugs. The first one is tanezumab. Okay, what is it? What is tanezumab? It is a monoclonal antibody against narrow growth factor. Now, I do understand that I have not made you to do a deep dive into the pathogenesis of osteoarthritis, because that is considered more of a territory of PG students. Just remember that there is something called as narrow growth factor, and it also plays a role in the pathogenesis of osteoarthritis. So by blocking this, we may be able to derive some benefits. So there is one drug that is called as tanezumab. Obviously, it's a monoclonal antibody. Right. The second newer drug I want you to know and remember is fasitibant, which is a bradykinin 2 receptor antagonist. Okay, so whenever you hear this bunt, right, remember probably it is a drug which blocks the bradykinin 2 receptor antagonist. Can anybody tell me where else you hear this bunt? Yes, you're right. There is something called as icatibant. We use it in the treatment of, where do we use it? We use it in the treatment of hereditary angioedema, which is also a bradykinin 2 receptor antagonist. So I think we have covered the important MCQ points. I know orthopedic side, they will be covering something about the joint deformities, and those are also important from the perspective of orthopedics. From medicine, I think this is more than enough, including pathophysiology. This is more than enough. I will be signing off now. I will be loading a lot more videos on the rheumatology section in the subsequent days.